between Sanskrit studies and the history of Indian mathematics and astronomy. The main difference between him and his colleagues whom you have this morning is that all of these have been doing history of Indian science as a kind of hobby or side activity. This will be also the case of Dr. Amartya and Dr. Leitanar. Whereas Vikrama Subramaniam is with IIT Bombay, where there is a self, what is the official?
Yeah, Self for Indian Science and Technology.
Right. So he's been there for several years. But close, he's a very close colleague of Dr. Anish Nivas and Dr. Sriram. In fact, together with one or two others, I jokingly call them the Madras School of Mathematics and Astronomy. And they've been involved in all these translations, critical editions, and original research also.
Why jokingly? It's a serious business. Why?
Well, jokingly because we have the Kerala School for Mathematics and Astronomy. So I call this the Madras School of...
Okay, thanks for the kind introduction, Michelle, and I'm also extremely happy to get associated with the Sandhi initiative, and we also keep doing something at IIT Bombay, and I had occasions to visit here when the Sandhi initiative was undertaken by IIT Kanpur. Today I thought I would discuss certain aspects of Shankaravarya's work. Shankaravarya was कैसे जाता है दिस विल वर्क ऑन दिस आर ओके 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 ये इसमें जाएगा एक मिनट इस कैसे करेंगे नहीं जा रहा है ना ठीक मैं इससे करूँ कोई बात नहीं या सो शंकरवारियार वॉज वन अमंग द लीडिंग मैथमेटिशियंस एंड एस्ट्रोनॉमर्स ऑफ द केरला स्कूल but towards the end of that. So it commences around 1340 with Madhava, and then he lived around 1540 and so on. And later there were a few people, Achyuta Pisharadi, Pudumana Somayaji and so on. But the lineage goes like this, Madhava to Parameshwara, and then
center.
Okay. And then Parameshwara's son was Damodara, and Damodara was the teacher of the famous Nilakanta Somayaji. Nilakanta Somayaji has written two important works. I mean, of course, he has several works, 8 to 10 works, but the one which may be considered monumental are Tantra Sangraha and Aryabhatiya Bhashya. So Tantra Sangraha, as Professor Sriram was mentioning in the morning, so that has been studied, but Aryabhatiya Bhashya in its entirety has not been studied so far. So certain sections have been analyzed by certain scholars. And Jyeshtadeva, as you might have heard, so is the author of the celebrated work Yukti Bhasha. And the work of Jyeshtadeva and Shankaravarya are more or less similar. The difference is Jyeshtadeva has composed his text in Malayalam, whereas Shankaravarya has written in Sanskrit. Shankaravarya's commentary called Yukti Deepika on Tantra Sangraha is primarily in the form of verses. He has also written a commentary in prose which is called Laghu Vivriti, and Yukti Deepika is far more detailed compared to Laghu Vivriti. He digresses on to various topics, and one can say in some sense whatever that has been covered in Yukti Bhasha has more or less been covered by Shankaravarya in his Yukti Deepika. So Laghu Vivriti goes more close to the primary text, but Yukti Deepika digresses on various topics. And Kriyakramakari is another important commentary which has been authored by Shankaravarya, and it is through these two works that we come to know of many of the original verses of Madhava. So this is in that sense also very important to study Yukti Deepika and Kriyakramakari. Kriyakramakari is by far the largest commentary on Leelavati, I would say, which discusses various topics in great detail. Okay. Normally, what is expected of a commentary is one would like to know what is conveyed in the original text. This one can call as ukta artha. Ukta is stated, artha is meaning. So, one has to elaborate on that. So, this is one aspect which has to be done by commentator, and this is mandatory. Commentary, if we say bhashya, okay. Uktartha pratipadanam, so this is done, and the other thing which is taken up by a commentator is anuktartha ullekhanam. So, that which has not been stated in the text, but something which is related to, which can substantiate what has been stated in the text. So, that also can be analyzed and interspersed into the commentary. So, this is anuktartha ullekhanam, so you bring into that commentary. And the third is duruktartha parishilanam. So, something which has not been stated precisely in the text, so can be commented upon by the commentator. So, this doesn't seem to be appropriate, one has to think on it, so on, so on and so forth. So, these are primary aspects which one expects in a commentary, and not all commentaries take all these aspects. There are certain commentaries which may be called as laghu tippani, where they do not really analyze this first aspect, they do not do uktartha pratipadanam. It has been done in some other commentary, and therefore, I just give certain notes. So, that also is possible. So, simply duruktartha parishilanam can also be found in certain commentaries, but by and large, so all these three aspects are taken care by a commentator, good commentator. And in this sense, I would say Shankara really excels particularly in this Kriyakramakari and Yukti Deepika. The text Yukti Deepika, it is rather very elaborate. Sometimes you will find some 300 verses on a particular topic, so which will be introduced by Shankara Variyar, and the title which has been given is a compound word. As all of you can easily realize, there is a term called Yukti, there is a term called Deepika. So, one can derive this word in three or four ways. Yuktihi eva deepika, yukti deepika. Yuktihi deepika eva is another way of deriving the word. And the third is yuktya deepika, yuktayaha deepyante yatra. I will just tell this. Yuktihi eva deepika, when you say, yukti alone is something which can throw light. Suppose you have a certain theorem, unless you understand the proof of it, you will not be able to get into it. So, the rationale behind it, and therefore, yukti alone sheds enough light into the topic. So, this is one thing. The other is yuktihi deepikaiva. So, this is another way of saying yukti definitely illuminates. Okay. So, without that also, I may have a certain understanding of that thing, but the moment I have this yukti, it actually throws much more light on what I have understood. Yuktya deepika, so the one which illuminates because of having yukti in it. So, this the last two derivations straight away refer to the text. The first two actually highlights on what deepika yukti is, and of course, atra pratipadyante, so in whichever text, so you can call it as yukti deepika. Yuktayaha deepyante yatra, so those which are brought out in a significant manner, in which, so that is what is called Yukti Deepika. So, I do not know, maybe he had all these things in his mind and he called it as Yukti Deepika. Of course, Yukti Bhasha also, Yuktayaha Bhashyante, Bhashyante, the other Malayalam text which I was referring to. So, wherever these Yuktis are being presented, okay, Yuktayaha Bhashyante, Bhashayam, that is also another derivation which people say. Yuktis have been presented in the local language. Okay. What is this yukti? So, Agnivesha, he says, buddhif pashyati ya bhavan bahukarana yogajan युक्ति ही त्रिकाला साज्ञेया त्रिवर्गः साध्यते यया। युक्ति ही चरक संहिता इन आयुर्वेदिक टेक्स्ट इनफैक्ट ही गिव्स सेवरल एग्जांपल्स एंड देन ही आल्सो डिफाइन्स वॉट युक्ति इज इन दैट पर्टिकुलर कॉन्टेक्स्ट विच विल बी एक्सट्रीमली यूजफुल एंड विच हैज टू बी डेफिनेटली नोन बाय एनीवन हु एडमिनिस्टर्स मेडिसिन ऑन अदर्स। ओके बुद्धि पश्यति या भावान। बुद्धि ही यू कैन टेक इट एज इंटेलेक्ट। ओके द इंटेलेक्ट विच इज एबल टू सी थिंग्स विच इज एबल टू परसीव थिंग्स। बुद्धि पश्यति या भावान। भावान कैन रेफर टू एनीथिंग दैट वी आर डीलिंग विथ। बहुकारण योगजान। सो नथिंग कम्स जस्ट लाइक दैट। देर आर वेरियस फैक्टर्स विच प्ले ए मेजर रोल इन समथिंग विच इज कमिंग आउट एज एन एंड। सो बहुकारण योगजान। योगा इज बेसिकली यूनिटी। सो द convolution of various factors which can bring out this disease, which can bring out this result, which can bring out anything. Okay, bahukarana yogajan yuktihi trikala sajneya. So that is what is to be understood. So it is, he is referring to a certain faculty which is able to visualize this, and he calls that as yuktihi. Okay, trikala sajneya trivargaha sadhyate ya. So this is in fact what is stated in praise of it. So the importance of it is being conveyed by trikala sajneya. So that is applicable at various times. Okay, trikala and trivargaha sadhyate ya. So this is really in praise of the importance of yukti. Trivargaha, this varga has various meanings. Here it is used in the sense of purushartha. So trivargaha is the word which we find in the classical texts. Later this normal pursuits of a human being, so dharma, artha, kama, so and moksha. So in the earlier texts, even in Ramayana and other places, even Arthashastra, you will find, even Arthashastra you will find only three things stated. So dharma, artha, kama. So once they are in place, so of course moksha is a natural derivative. I mean, that is how they thought. And anyway, so what he is saying is trivargaha sadhyate yaya. Yaya refers to that particular faculty, so by which you will be able to achieve all the three pursuits. Okay, so this is how yukti is defined. So this actually conveys the importance of understanding
what is trikala
in this context. Trikala, so the yukti that you are trying to present should be valid in all the three times. Trikala yesha yuktihi. So I will give you a few examples. Which I have chosen belong to different categories. And one set is simple explanation, as I was telling, uktartha pratipadanam, how he does, a few examples for that. Then whatever that has not been stated in the text, so anuktartha ullekhanam and parishilanam. So I will try to present three examples, all the three varieties. The first verse in Tantra Sangraha goes like this: He Vishnu nihitam kutsam jagatvayeva karane jyotisham jyotishetasmi namo narayanayate. It is just to give a flavor of how a commentator goes about. So this verse has a word namaha. So namaha normally means reverence, veneration. So here he even defines that namo prakvi bhavo namaskara shabdarthaha sarvavinmataha. So this is, he is saying, so prakvi bhavaha. So what do we mean by say namaste? So he says you are trying to physicalize the attitude that you have towards the other person. So you convey the humility. Prakvi bhavaha is basically humility. So namaskara shabdarthaha sarvavinmataha. And he says it is appropriate that you do to the person who is Vishwakarana. Okay, atas tadrang namaskarat siddhet sarvam yathepsitam. This I will not dwell upon. So this why is it that he actually introduces this Mangalacharana and his own venerations is introduced into the text? That is something which is discussed in detail in various other shastras, nyaya. The other point is, so jagat tvayeva karane nihitam. Nihitam means usually, so that which rests upon. Okay, so So Twayeva Karane Nihitam. So that is and he also describes this Narayana as Jyotisham Jyotihi. So these two points he wants to bring out Shankara. Mrittikayam yathabhati kritsnam kumbhagatadikam narayane tathabhati jagadeta characharam jagatkaranata tasya nirvivada tathastita. So he is giving an example. So if you conceive of various things that have been generated by a potter, so using the clay. So all the 100 different entities which he has generated are none other than the mud, clay alone. So that is karana, and therefore you can describe that all these 100 entities are none other than the clay. So that is karana. So in that sense he says jagat, the entire universe, so which you see in the manifest form, is born out of this Narayana, and therefore jagat kritsnam mrittikayam nihitam yatha nihitam vastu jatam tatha. So that is what he wants to bring out. And then this another thing which one is expected to do is one should try to cite certain other examples which are available. So to make you understand much more clearer that this is what has been stated elsewhere also. So that is what he brings in when he says Jyotisham Jyotishe. So therefore he cites a verse from Yadaditya Gatam Chedo Jagat Bhasete Kalam. So this is basically from Bhagavad Gita. So whatever the illumination that you find in any illuminating body is from that source of illumination, so which is the so this is actually brought in to say that this is karana, and therefore this is also brought in. So I will go to the next example. So this is just to show you that he takes every aspect of the verse and then tries to explain. The other interesting thing that he brings out, so which has not been stated in the text, as I was mentioning, anuktartha parishilanam, which may be useful in trying to understand. So when he describes the revolution of sun to be causing the day, so there are different kinds of days that one can think of. The time interval between two star rises can be thought of a day. The time interval between two sunrises can be thought of a day. So here both are stated in this verse. Ravev pratyak brahmam prahuhu savanakhyam dinam arksham rikshabhramam tadvat jyotisham preraku marutu. So here the word muhurmuhuhu comes, muhurmuhuhu, again and again. So there he says muhurmuhuhu ittenena sarvesham tadbhaganaanam mithaha kalasamyam darishitam. So what he is trying to say is, so the earth spins. So the spinning of the earth, so is happening at a uniform rate, muhurmuhuhu, again and again. So again and again should be understood in this context as kalasamyam. Again and again refers to this, it is the same period in which the things come back. So that is what is pointed out. And another interesting thing that he points out here is kalo yatav parichedyaha jyotishchakra paribhramat. This is again a very important thing. So time is conceived to be something which is unbounded and which is eternal. The limited time that we conceive of, may it be a month, may it be a week, may it be a year, so or any other time period for that matter. So this is all something which has to be understood with reference to something that is happening around. So if the period in which the earth spins, so changes a bit, then the duration of day will also change a bit. So that is what he is trying to say. Jyotishchakra paribhramat. So it is essentially due to the revolution of the celestial objects which are happening around you. You conceive of limited time. So the limited time, the limitation in the time is something which has been brought out by this. And of course, there are larger scales and smaller scales of time which these people talk about. Okay. So we have Mahayuga, we have Truti and so on and so forth which go down. So this is another thing which has not been brought in the text, but he goes on to discuss and impress upon this. So this is and in fact this parichedyaha means limited. Okay. So kalaha parichedyaha, limitation in time is essentially brought out by this. And in fact this is very close to what Aryabhata has says, kalo ayam anadyanantaha grahabhaihi anumiyate kshetre. See, anadyanantaha kalaha, see anadi ananta, so we don't know when the time came into existence and when it going to end, so as a concept. But grahabhaganaihi parichedya, see that is what he is saying, grahabhaihi anumiyate. Okay. Then okay, so this is another thing. Samsarpa Namhaspati, Professor Iyengar was talking about the Vedic astronomy and astronomy which has been practiced in very early times and the kind of references. So, these two terms, Samsarpa and Amhaspati, occur in the Vedic literature. In fact, there is a passage in Yajurveda which lists the names of 13 months. Madhuscha Madhavascha Shukrascha Shuchischa Nabhascha Nabhasyascheshascha Urjascha Sahascha Sahasyascha Upayamagrihitosi Samsarpposyamhaspatyayatva. So, this is the passage which goes. There, this name Samsarpa and Amhaspati occur. And here, he clearly elaborates and then says that the Samsarpa and Amhaspati are related to those things which have been stated there. And they have to be understood as the intercalary month, which we call as Adhika Masa. So, when we have to blend the solar and the lunar calendar, so we may have to introduce a certain month in the lunar calendar, so that it goes in consonance with the solar calendar. Every 3 years or so we may have to do. And here it can happen, say this is not just like introducing one day in February arbitrarily. So, this Adhika Masa is something which is determined based on some astronomical phenomenon which is happening. The lunar month should have no sankramana of the sun. Sankramana essentially is transit. So, normally between two Amavasyas there could be a transit of sun from one Rashi to other Rashi. If it does not happen, then that particular month is called as Adhika Masa. And it can also so happen once in a while that a particular lunar month has two sankramanas, two suns transit. This other way around. So, a lunar month need not have a solar transit, it can have two transits also. So, here the name Samsarpa and Amhaspati, so he clarifies that Samsarpa is that particular month, so in which there are two transits, and Amhaspati is, so these two form a part of the year. So, one refers to the month having two transits, the other refers to the month having no transit, but there will be another Adhika Masa. So, those things are also very clearly explained by Shankaravarya. So, this is one thing which I wanted to point out. And of course, this is a very, very important thing. In fact, our group in early 90s, when we were studying this text, so this particular statement which has been beautifully brought out by Shankaravaryar made us discover this kind of a model made by Neelakantha. So, Divyabdhanam Sahasrani Dvadashaikam Chaturyujam Suryasya and so on. So, there when he is presenting the revolutions made by the planets, so the number of revolutions made by Mercury, made by Venus, made by Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, everything will be presented. The number of revolutions made by the apogees of the planets, made by the nodes of the planets, all of them are stated. When he presents this, Neelakantha uses the word Nyasya Swaparyayaha. Nyasya, Nya refers to Mercury. Nyasya Swaparyayaha, Nyasya Paryayaha, he could have just stated, but Swa, so what is the significance of introducing the word Swa? So, this has been brought out by Shankaravaryar. Nyasya Swaparyayaha Punaha Nagaveda Nabhas Sapta Ramanka Swarabhumayaha. So, this is basically in Bhuta Sankhya. So, this is the number of revolutions. Atra swashabdena paryayanam bhaskaradyabhimatam swashighrocha sambandhitvam budhasya nirastam. So, this is a very important statement, so which made us ponder over, and then so we came up with that paper. So, here this budhasya nirastam, so budha refers to Mercury and nya also refers to Mercury. He says by specifically introducing the word sva, so Neelakantha wants to convey the fact that the number of revolutions which are normally associated with what is known as Shighrocha of the Mercury, So he is something which is not appropriate, and it has to be associated with the planet itself. So this is a very important statement. So then we found out references in various other texts, how Nilakantha presents and so on and so forth. The point anyway is, so whenever we find something which is specific, so that has been brought out so clearly by Shankaravarya. So that is one thing which I wanted to point out. And of course, he describes the same thing in the form of verses also. As I told you, so he has a prose commentary which is called Laghu Vivritti, and he also has an elaborate commentary called Yukti Deepika, and Yukti Deepika is in the form of verses. Again, see, Buddha Bhargavayor Vrittam. Bhargava refers to Venus. Shaighra Nichocha Vrittatam Yati Tasmin Swagattiva Charataha Buddha Shukrayoho Yugothaf Parayastvete Tat Swashabdena Darishitam. So this is also another interesting passage which we find in Yukti Deepika. How do we understand that sun makes this number of revolutions, moon makes this number of revolutions, and how do we find out their actual position from the mean position, and the tools whether we are employing are to be considered as mimicking the reality, or is it something which has to be conceived merely as tools? So all those points have been succinctly brought out. So just after the number of revolutions have been stated by Nilakantha, so Shankaravaryar presents a few verses. He says there are two kinds of motions. One is this apparent westward motion which we keep seeing. Another thing is the actual motion of the planet towards the east. So this apparent motion is westward because the earth spins the other way around. Here he says grahanam prangmukhi bhuktihi svavyapara krutodita. Svavyapara is its own action. Driksamvada vishuddhau vishuddha asau grihyate golavittamaihi. This is again a very important point. So if Aryabhatta has given some number of revolutions, should it be taken as sacrosanct and should never be refined at all, or we should go ahead and then make observations and then refine the parameter values? So there he says Driksamvada vishuddha asau. See, asau refers to the eastward motion of the planet. So x may be the number of revolutions which has been stated by Aryabhatta for Mercury, and if you find that this is not in concordance, you may make it as x plus 2, you can make it as x minus 4. So driksamvada vishuddha means that which is refined based upon your own observation, and that is what is taken by golavittamaihi, those who are experts in spherics, astronomy and so on. Yatkrita nikhilah karya. Okay, then talking about the models which have been presented, he says uchanicha paridhyadihi arthapatya niyamyate atindriyascha bhaganaha niyamyante anumanatah. This is a very important statement. So the model which was earlier shown by Professor Sriram during his talk, so certain circles drawn on certain other circles and then trying to locate the planet, so they are referred to as paridhihi. Paridhi is the dimension, and it also refers to the circumference. So uccha neecha paridhyadi, this uccha circle, neecha circle and so on, whatever you conceive of, arthapatya niyamyate. Arthapatya is a certain, arthapati is considered as a certain pramana, okay, by means you, by means of which you derive a knowledge. So suppose I wanted to know Professor Iyengar is present, then I should have light, okay, so contacting my eyes and his body, okay, then only I will know, or I should hear his voice, whatever it is, this is a certain mode. So how do you know he was present? I saw him, you can say. I heard his voice, you can say. So this is a certain pramana. So similarly, the means by which you derive a valid knowledge is called a pramana, and arthapati is one kind of pramana. I will not dwell upon that. So arthapatya niyamyate atindriyascha bhaganaha. In fact, he says you will not be able to say how many number of revolutions are made by sun, okay, so in a large period, how many number of revolutions made by moon in a large period. So even in one revolution you may be able to say that so this is the number of days which is taken. So you can find out 10 revolutions of moon and then say it is close to 273 days. So observe for 20 revolutions, observe for 200 revolutions, then you will be able to get much better and better value. So what he is saying is atindriyascha means that which is not clearly evident to your sense organ. For instance, in the case of nodes, the nodes of all the orbits are also making revolution. So equinox is actually moving. So today morning we discussed about precession. How long can a person live in order to know this? There is no way. So therefore he says anumanataha niyamyante, it is only by inference that we will be able to derive precise values. So atindriyascha bhaganaha, bhaganaha revolution numbers of various objects, various celestial things are to be inferred by inference niyamyante tesham shastreshu nanatvam pariksha taratamyataha. See, so Aryabhatta might have given something, Brahmagupta might have given something, Bhaskara might have given something. Nanatvam is variability in that. So why is it that they are variables? So here he says pariksha taratamyataha, so the examination that they have done. So taratamya is something which is inferior, superior and so on and so forth. This is what is called taratamya. So it is because of that. But another important point that he says is ataha sarveshu shastreshu. See, this is something which one has to understand. See, when we look at different texts, so different things have been stated. So how is it that they can state different values? There has to be only one value. That is not true at all. In fact, as time changes, so today morning when Professor Sriram was making, so this the obliquity of the ecliptic is taken to be 24 degrees by the Indian astronomers. In fact, it is a variable. It can go beyond 25 and can go less than 23 also. So now it is in the phase of decreasing. So today the value is around 23 degrees and 4 minutes, 23.4 degrees. So earlier it might have been 24,500 years back when these people were doing this. So it is something which is a dynamic thing. It does not remain constant, and therefore observations has to be done periodically and things have to be refined. So that is the point which he is trying to drive. See, he says ataha sarveshu sugrahatvaya tatsiddham sarvam yatra upadishyate ataha sarveshu shastreshu nyayamarga pradarshishu sankhya bhagam prathakritya babhanuhu golachintakaha. So golachintakaha, so those who have been thinking about this seriously, means scholars, experts, golachintakaha, the scholars on spherics. So what they have done is they have separately given the number of revolutions in a section. So this is primarily this because this is something which will be refined based on observation at a later point of time. And therefore he says nyayamarga pradarshishu, so in the principles which are being enunciated by them, they always segregate these revolution numbers and state it. Okay. So this has been stated to some extent by Professor Sriram in the morning, but I will just very quickly run through this and then move on to other interesting topics. This is again a very interesting question that has been posed by various people, and different astronomers have given explanation as to how the earth can remain unsupported. So this would have been a question which has been bothering them. So every object falls, should the earth also not fall? So here he gives two different kinds of arguments. So the question that he poses is tishtet katham bhumihi khamadhyeso nirashraya gurutvat nabhasaha tasyaha yapatanam nabhavet katham patam patanam katham nabhavet. Why is it that it does not fall? And why are you saying this? Is it because, I mean, I find every object to be falling and this is a heavy object and therefore this has to also fall somewhere and then rest on something. Okay, so this is the question. Then he says, so you have to conceive of earth. So from this think of two different fellows. Of course he pointed out various places, Yavakoti on the other side 90 degrees from this, and then the other points. So think of two different points which are diametrically opposite. So that fellow also feels that he is falling this side, this fellow also feels that he is falling this side. So then he sort of argues that both these things are mutually opposite to each other. See, so bhuprishtha vayavaha sarve golardhantari tattvataha. See, golardha is exactly at 180 degrees on the other side, so on the other half of the hemisphere. Samantat pratibadhananti mithaha. So he says these two so try to fall, okay. So on opposite directions, and they bind themselves. I mean, that is the kind of thing he is saying. They tie themselves from all quarters, and therefore it remains like that. Khamadhyat patana bhavaha bhugolasitu tato dhruvaha golakaratvamapyasya samantat samagor. Then he is another kind of argument. He is nanutishthe nanutishthe. See, even if you say no, this is not something which is acceptable to me. This may be binding each other, and then earth may not fall apart because there is a certain force of attraction towards the center of the earth. You can think of. But then the body as such should fall. So that is another line of thing. Nanatishtati kochit, we don't observe any object, so just floating in space. So this is another thing that he says. Ashrayena vina, without a locus, we don't find any object standing in space. Tadrisho pyashrayaha asya, if you want to say that, then I would say you can think of the space itself as supporting. So tadrishopi ashrayaha asya nabhayeva nirantaram, the space itself should be conceived as. Then he says space is after all nothing, so it is only vacuum. So it doesn't have any form, no matter. So then he says ashraya ashray bhavascha mitho bhuteshu drishyate. So we can think of bhuta is any being, okay. So ashraya ashray bhava, ashraya is something which is the locus, and ashrayi which is supported by the locus. And he says, so this ashraya ashray bhava can be thought of in very many ways. So therefore space can be considered as ashraya for that can be considered as ashraya for this. So this is another interesting way. Murta murta vibhagopi tatra akinchit karo bhavet. Akinchit kara means it is something which is not worthwhile discussing, or very simple argument, okay. So coming to the discussion on sine function, so this India, one of the major contributions made by Indians is to present a certain recursive relation for generation of sine table. So this has been done in 5th century, and in fact Professor Mumford was so thrilled when he came to know that they have presented the difference form of that equation, finite difference form of the second order differential equation. So this is basically the equation. So let us not worry about how this comes from this, but the point that I wanted to make here was, so here something which has been given as a fairly good approximation, so has been touched upon by Shankaravaryar, and then say much more accurate values have been used by different people, though Neelakantha does not present in the text. So Neelakantha wanted to give it only correct to seconds, but the value is much more precisely known, and it is known to Madhava, and he has given those more appropriate values. So this has been given by Shankaravaryar. He says vilipta dasakonajya, the first value, so you take the arc of 225 minutes, the first r sine value, so sine of 3 degrees 45 minutes. So we know sine theta is close to theta when the value is very small. So there he says, so how close, so if it is less, slightly less, how much less? So vilipta dashakona, so it is 224 minutes and 50 seconds. So this is what? So the sine value of first 225 minutes is 224 minutes and 50 seconds. So this is what he says, vilipta dashaka, dashaka is 10, 24 and 50, but here he says vilipta rupameva jachapantaram abhipretya vilipta dashakam uktam. So this is what has been stated by Neelakantha, considering the accuracy up to seconds. But then vastutaha punaha ashtatrimshat tatparadhikam vilipta navakameva etat. So atayeva bhagaharopi natatra sardha devashvi tulyaha. So in this recursive relation, what you find in the denominator is 233 and half. So here he says, so in this recursive relation, this 233 and half is only an approximation, and the more accurate value is 223 plus 32 by 60. So what I wanted to say was, so Shankaravaryar, so wherever it is essential to supplement something and point out that more accurate values can be done by various other people, or if he wants to state also, he states. And as I was mentioning earlier, so one of the great services in some sense which has been done by Shankaravaryar is to bring to light this Madhava's contribution, because we do not find the various things which are available as done by Madhava. So in fact when he was discussing the sine function, he actually quotes the verse which has been given by Madhava. So this is the sine table which has been stated by Madhava. See, for instance, Reshtam Nama Varishthanam. This is in Katapayadi, 224, 50, 22. In fact, this is what I was mentioning. So Neelakantha, so states is at 224, 50, but then 22 has to be added. This is what is more accurate value. He goes to the thirds more than seconds. And in fact, if you do with any modern computer, So this is what you will have. So up to 8 decimal places, so this value is accurate. So 2, 24, 50, 22. So this is what. So he actually lists a set of verses and finally says, "Tatparadi kalantastu mahajya madhavoditaha." Madhavoditaha means has been stated by Madhava. So this is how we come to know that Madhava has given. So this sign table. So in about. So each verse will have 4 values. In 6 verses, he will give the entire sign table. Okay. See, we all know that the duration of day is not something which is constant at any given location. So unless one is on equator, so where the duration of day and night will be equal, exactly 12 hours. So if you are off the equator, then it is not equal. So by what measure is it not equal? How do we conceive of this? So there are certain prescriptions by which you will be able to determine by what duration the duration of day will increase, okay, on any given day. So that has to do with the declination of the sun and the location of the observer, latitude. So in this context, so Nilakantha has prescribed certain corrections, and there Shankaravaryar very clearly explains how do you draw the circle and how do we conceive and all that. So that is what I want to tell you. As a commentator, he says, see, Svakshaihi Svakshitijam Nyeyau Udayastamayo Ravehe Unmandala Kshitijayoho Antarala Dhanuhu Charam. Nilakantha will simply say that you have to find out Chara and apply it. So what is this Chara? So he beautifully explains. He says, Udayastamayo Ravehe Unmandala Kshitijayoho. Unmandala refers to this circle. See, a circle which is passing through the east-west point and the north celestial pole. This is what is called Unmandala. And then you think of the line, the diurnal circle of the sun, and whatever be the angle between these two great circles. So this is what you should understand as Chara. So, and then he says, so this duration, so will be more or less symmetrical on the other side, and therefore he says, Atas Charena Dvighnena. So when you multiply this Chara, so delta alpha by 2 times, so you will be able to determine the duration by which the day increases, so for a given declination and for a given latitude. So all that has been beautifully explained by Shankaravaryar. So I will skip this, and then this is another interesting discussion. So you can have several things determined by a very very simple tool. Today morning, in fact, Michelle was asking why were people not interested when telescope was introduced. So they had certain devices which were serving their own purposes. Okay. So a very simple device which they call as Shanku. So all that it has is a stick of a given length, and then you should have a flat surface. So given this, you will be able to determine several things, the latitude of a place, the directions precisely, and then so from the shadow you will also be able to determine what the time is exactly. So all this has been discussed in this text. So this will be discussed in a chapter called Triprashnadhikara. I am giving one example wherein Shankaravaryar beautifully explains how to resolve a certain circularity in the argument. Okay. The most important thing that they have to do is determine the exact east-west direction at a given location. How do you determine that? Suppose I want to know, I have gone to a place and I do not know what exactly east or west is. And if I have to start a construction, then the first thing that I have to do is determine the east, west and north, south direction exactly. So this method is something which is described even in Sulva Sutras. So there is a Shanku. Shanku is basically a stick you erect at a given location. You ensure that the surface is flat, draw a certain circle, erect the stick, and then you measure the shadow. As the shadow enters into this circle, you mark this point, and the shadow exits, you mark another point. But this will not give you exactly the precise east-west. There may be minor correction which is involved. And this minor correction is because the sun's declination does not remain constant even over a given day. So you know that declination keeps continuously changing. This is what we call as Uttarayana and Dakshinayana. On any given day, it is not going to, it is a continuously changing variable. So if you are making this measurement, So, though you have ensured that the surface is plane and a circle is drawn around the stick, so the shadow enters at a point, you mark that point as the west point, and in the afternoon the shadow exits the circle, that point you call as east point. When you make this, so this is something like that, see. So, W prime and E prime are what is done. See, tachhayagram spreshedyatra vritte purva aparanayoho satra bindu nidhatavyo, these are to be called as east and the west point. But then he does not stop here. In fact, this there is a small correction which you have to do to ensure that the point that you have marked is exactly pointing to the east west direction, and the change in declination has to be considered. For that, Nilakantha prescribes a correction, and here is where it becomes very interesting. So, this is the formula which Nilakantha gives. Okay. So, bhedat purva aparakrantyoho. Suppose the declination when the shadow enters into the circle is delta 1 in the forenoon, and when the shadow exits this circle, say it is delta 2, declination of the sun. Then this correction, the magnitude by which one of these points, either east or the west point, has to be corrected is given by this equation. So, k refers to the hypotenuse of this. So, this Ox in the figure refers to shanku, and Oy is the shadow, and Xy is the hypotenuse. This is a right angle triangle. The magnitude of the correction is given by this r sin delta 1 minus sin delta 2 by r cos phi, where phi is the latitude of the observer. Okay. So, the latitude of the observer is phi. So, this correction, once you do this and then you apply it to one of these points, then it gets corrected and you will get exact east west. Now, the question is, how do you know the latitude of the place? If you have determined east west direction, so you conduct a simple experiment and this point has to be refined further, and that expression by which you have to refine this point, correct this point, depends on phi. How do you calculate phi given latitude? This again can be determined by the same shanku. So, exactly when the sun makes the transit in the meridian transit, okay. So, when it moves right at 12 o'clock local time, so when it actually crosses, so if you measure the shadow, so that actually will give you the zenith distance of the sun, and that zenith distance of the sun, so from that you will be able to determine phi, you can say that. But then when you are saying that I have to exactly find at the meridian transit, then you should know this east west direction first of all. When you are making a shadow measurement here, so you should know the east west line in order to determine phi, and you should know phi in order to determine the exact east west line. Okay. So, now this problem of circularity comes into this. So, I will just leave this. So, this is another discussion which he takes in. The interdependency in the calculation of phi and delta. Delta refers to the correction and phi refers to the latitude. So, look at this. He says, Nanu lambena siddhena. Lamba refers to r cos phi. Kartavyam krantijam phalam. Krantijam phalam is delta. So, this is born out of delta difference and therefore, it is called krantijam phalam. So, one, if you know phi, you will be able to determine delta. But then he says, Vishuvaddina madhyanna chayataha akshalambako. You have to determine phi on a particular day, okay, Vishuvaddina madhyanna chaya. But then chaya, the moment you say, so it has to be the chaya which falls on east west line, and you will not be able to determine that precisely before determining the direction, and therefore he says, chakragrastataya bhavet. So you have given two procedures which are interdependent, and how am I to do this? Okay. Chakragrastataya bhavet. So, this is the question. This is all in Shankaravarya's discussion. The text does not stay this, says this. And there he goes on and then explains how you can overcome this kind of circularity. Tataha ayanante madhyanne. So, I will just resort to the board for a moment and then marker kahan hai bhai? Okay. So, suppose this is the zenith and say sun. What he is saying is, so let us take this as the ecliptic and so let us say this is equator. So the sun keeps moving in a path which is inclined by a measure epsilon, and let us say this refers to the declination of the sun, and this the longitude lambda. So we are related by a simple expression, sin delta is sin epsilon sin lambda. So once you know the longitude of the sun, you will be able to determine the declination. Now what he is saying is, you conduct the experiment on such a day that this variation in the declination will be minimal or zero. So what do you do? So that is what he says. See, ayananta. So ayananta is the day on which a particular ayana ends. Ayana basically refers to motion. We have uttarayana means northerly motion. So the sun's declination changes from -23 to +23, let us say. So you choose one of these points, either -23 or +23. At that point, so when you conceive of these two circles, the change in the declination will be zero momentarily. So you choose that particular day. In fact, there are very precise statements which are there. I will not be able to explain that in great detail, but the point that I want to make here is, see, he says, see, ayanante madhyanne dinapurvanhayoho. So you do that, and once you differentiate, you will find that cos lambda appears. So when lambda is 90 or 270, the change in declination is 0. Choose that particular day, and then this, once the change in declination is 0, so that expression delta can be determined. So if you go back, so this expression, see, the change in declination is 0, and therefore you will be able to determine this precisely. And once you determine this precisely, you have the exact east-west line, then you go ahead and find out phi, and you will be able to do it. So this is another interesting thing which Shankaravarya explains in his commentary. So mera samay abhi 5 minute hai ki ho gaya?
No, but if you have the +23 and -23 comes by, not just take the center, and you don't need all these calculations.
Pardon? It is not possible. No, it is not possible.
You say it has to be done.
No, no, no. You will be able to precisely determine what the longitude of the sun is. Longitude, for longitude determination, you don't need anything.
Right.
You just require a certain procedure which has been described, and you know the revolution number, you know the mean velocity, you know the eccentricity, you will be able to determine the longitude. So when the longitude, but what I mean is, so when it is in the ayananta, the longitude is 90 degrees. So you don't need to do anything. So you have to know when the longitude becomes exactly 90. So at that moment, you have to just make this measurement. So it is in ayananta, and that will give you this. So this correction will become 0, and therefore when you measure the shadow madhyanna chaya, that will give you phi exactly. So then you will be able to determine exact east west, and then on any other day you will be able to measure this. So that is what it is. Okay, only one example I will give on mathematics. I think my time may be over. We started around 215, 210?
210.
210. Okay, so I will just give one a quick example and then I will wind up. Shankaravaryar, as I mentioned, so I gave you a few examples from the astronomy text, which is called Yukti Deepika, which is the commentary on Tantra Sangraha. I am just going to give one example as to how he nicely explains things in Leelavati. So, Leelavati, as I told you, so he just takes the opportunity whenever something can be introduced which will supplement the discussion. So he just does that. When this pi value, as stated by various people, have been listed, and soon after he gives a detailed derivation of this infinite series which was mentioned in the morning. Professor Shriram was mentioning, and you also asked this question. So we have this series. I will just tell that series, and then I will come back to this slide. as to why they were interested in giving this. See, binomial series expansion has been given by these Kerala astronomers. Why were they interested in doing that? So, this has an application in trying to prove the expression for the infinity series expression which they have given for pi. Okay. So, with that background, I will just proceed with this and then I will conclude. So, this consider this product A into C by B. So, this product so can be written as a series. So, in fact, at the first level you can write it like this, and other case if B is greater than C and B is less than C, there are two possibilities. So, in which case you write in one of these forms, and anyway you get this expression. Now, consider these two terms again say as a product like this, and then you can further expand. So, keep on expanding this, right? And this is precisely what is involved in trying to find out a beautiful expression which we have for pi, which was highly praised when Leibniz discovered it by the peers. So, you can keep on doing that. Okay. So, every product you can keep on expanding, and you will have this kind of a series. So, this they call it as dvitiya phala, tritiya phala, and so on and so forth. This is the slide with which I will conclude. So, you can have something like this product expanded in the form of series which is unending, it can keep on going. Having done a few times, Shankara says, evam muhuhu phalanayane kritepi yuktitaha kvapi na samaptihi. Yuktitaha means in principle. See, when you think of, so it can go on. See, any series which is a converging series, so think of 1000th term, think of the 5000th term. So, it may reduce in magnitude, but it will never become 0, right. So, yuktitaha kvapi samaptihi nasti tathapi yavadapeksham sukshmata mapadya. In fact, you are asking the notion of limit and all that. So, it all arises in this context. Yavadapeksham sukshmata mapadya. Yavadapeksham means as much as you require. So, you can compute pi up to 3 million places. Will you ever do for your computation purposes? You will not do. Yavad apeksham, I want only 8 degree accuracy, 8 decimal points, I will stop with that. So, similarly he is saying, yavad apeksham sukshmata mapadya, having made it as accurate as you want, paschatyanu upekshya, so leave the rest of the terms in the series, upekshya, ignoring them, so phalanayanam samapaniyam, at some stage you have to just end this. So, you have uttarottara phalanam nyunatvantu gunaharantarena gunakaran nyuna eva syat. See, in fact, when will this converge and when will this diverge? So, that also has been sort of hinted by him. So, uttarottara phalanam nyunatvantu. In fact, he says, see, if you keep including correction terms, there is logically no end to the series, phala parampara. So, the phala parampara is what parampara is the series. Okay. And for achieving a given accuracy, so we can terminate the series at a point. So, if B minus C is less than C, then the successive correction terms keep decreasing in this, and therefore, it will fetch you whatever you want. So, I think I will stop here because my time is over, and the point I wanted to convey was, so whenever it is required to bring in a certain clarity in what has been stated in the original, Shankara does not miss this opportunity and beautifully expresses it. Another advantage over Yukti Bhasha is, so people who know Malayalam, and of course the world Malayalam, can enjoy Yukti Bhasha, but Yukti Deepika being in Sanskrit and so too Kriyakramakari being in Sanskrit is something which will be extremely useful for a larger audience who do not know Malayalam language. So, more or less the contents have been covered by Shankara Variyar in Yukti Deepika as well as in Kriyakramakari. For instance, one particular verse, there will be around 30 pages in Kriyakramakari. So, particularly when he discusses this pi, this series, binomial series, convergence, proof and so on, and how they have found out various fast converging approximations. There are several verses which have been cited by him. And of course, there are certain novel features also have been introduced. So, those are more subtler aspects which one has to understand by repeatedly reading, so what he has done. So, so far, so neither Kriyakramakari has been fully understood and analyzed, nor Yukti Deepika for instance. So, they are very voluminous texts. So, certain sections have been studied by some of us, and this is one thing which is worthwhile undertaking. So with this I will conclude my talk. Thank you.
Duruktartha parishilanam is, so duruktartha is, I would use in the sense of this incomplete. So anuktartha is one thing. This duruktartha is this value which has been stated. So that is what I wanted to do. 50 minutes and so on. It has been stated, but it has been stated as half.
Some other commentator wrongly interpreted it.
Yeah, correct.
Bhushitartha.
Yeah.
Pariharana.
That is also possible, but I think he cites certain places, one can say that.
Some other commentator wrongly interpreted.
That is true. Yeah.
You can correct.
You can correct, sir. Akatataha Durutartasya Parishiram. That has been done.
I have one general question. This Kerala school, after this you said continued by Sanatana. I hear about Saraswati Amma. Actually contributed everything in this
No. Saraswati Amma has studied in great detail the geometry. So starting from Surya Sutra up to this series. So this all, this, they have a certain geometrical picture through which they derive all this into a series. So nice diagrams and so that is what is the contribution of Saraswati Amma is. Saraswati Amma, so geometry in ancient and medieval India. So that is the book, which is basically her thesis. So that is her contribution. Continuation of it is found in the works of Achyuta Pisharati. So, in fact, in one of the works of Achyuta Pisharati, so we find even the derivative of the two trigonometric functions. Okay? So, derivative of x, so f of x is in the numerator and g of x is in the denominator. So, you want to find d by dx of this, f of x by g of x. So, in that context also he gives a very interesting expression, so exact derivatives. So that is found in Achyuta Pisharati's work, in one of the Achyuta Pisharati's work. In fact, other work which we have been studying, myself, Professor Shriram Srinivas and another student of mine, is Karana Paddhati.
Do they have a special name for derivative?
Derivative, see, this use is found in the sense of Tatkalika Gati.
That's as good as derivative.
Exactly. That is all it is. Tatkali Vidyamana Gati. For instance, suppose somebody gives to 17 decimal places. So, that kind of accuracy may not be required and it is almost impossible for them to even put it in expression. But it is indirectly involved, okay, not directly involved, but not up to 17 decimal if somebody has given for 17 decimal places. So, a certain general scheme for obtaining as much accuracy as you want has also been stated. So, that way one can say it is for the pursuit of beauty, I mean in that sense you can say, but more or less, so all these are developed only in the context of so solving a specific problem.
So, during lunch we were discussing about Sanskrit and these texts, astronomical texts, and we
general feeling was the role in Sanskrit so that it could spread around. So that there is going to be an action. Why the Kerala school was not so widely known outside and continued?
No, no. See, the point is, Sanskrit, I would say, it is not for the purpose of having wide circulation, I would say. But that was the language which actually provided the necessary facility to compose whatever they wanted to compose. And in a text form. See, the choice of the language was not necessarily because it can reach more audience,
but more because it had the facility. But more because it had the facility. Yeah, it had facility to express things, and you can beautifully coin words, and that is how it was. And the development which has been in Sanskrit, and see this Kerala mathematics, I am not sure whether it was not known, because even in there is a stray reference to this widespread knowledge of the infinite series across this various places by Vish. So somewhere he mentions, so Vish in his article, so he mentions that in spite of the fact that this was known to various people in other locations beyond the boundary of Kerala, and of course there is a very interesting dialogue which goes on, and the discovery of Vish was not accepted by others. I mean, somewhere in that context he very clearly mentions that this discovery of Kerala school was also known beyond the boundary.
In South India.
Yeah.
Farming fields of Kanchipuram, Kannapadhi, manuscripts, Telugu manuscripts are.
Yeah. So definitely this Tamil Nadu, Andhra. I mean that that belt.
The Sundar Raja corresponding with Kerala. He is actually from Guntur. And he's from Tanjavur. Then I think it was known in the South Indian. Beyond that,
it didn't continue. The school did not continue.
That was for various reasons.
Historical
reasons. Under what conditions was the school born? I mean, was there any specific reason that Madhava.
No, Madhava, see, he definitely falls in Aryabhattan tradition. So, in fact, if we trace the development, this has been there. So, by 12th right. century, Bhaskara made certain things, and so Madhava was just 14th century. But I would say he was really brilliant, and there is one hint where we find that this was prevalent even before Madhava. See, in fact, this verse, Vibhushanetra Gajati Kutashana Vibhunaveda Bhavarana Bhavaha Parikimanam Idam Jagadur Bhutaha. So, the value of pi, which is given correct to 13 decimal places in the
verse. Jagadur is saying. Chakravaram Idam Jagadur.
Jagadur Bhutaha means wise men say this. So normally we ascribe this to Madhava, but the verse goes as wise men say this. So whether it was slightly before Madhava or only Madhava did this and then stated it in this form, we don't know.
Where exactly Madhava lived? That Sangamitrama, where is it located?
So we went and tried to find that location, but we were very unsuccessful. So, Irinyala Guda is what they say. Irinyala Guda.
How is that Kochi?
Yeah. Suburb of Kochi.
15 kilometers from Kochi.
So within some 20-30 kilometer radius. So all these astronomers. That area is known. But precisely we wanted to know his illam was there. Usually Indian will have some illam. Kerala. So that illam name we wanted to go, and even for the latest Archita Visharadi we were not able to find out. That area is known, but precisely. The temple is also known to some extent.
Shankaravali is the temple where he was working.
Yeah.
He was a temple servant. That is in very nice condition.
Yeah. Shri Kutasha temple.
Kutaveli.
Kutaveli. Okay. Thank you.